for his box.
Yeah.
He mangled the language, but he was as tough as nails, and like many labor leaders, socialists hated communism. Never for Americans, still many of them thought we could work these things out. Ernest Bevin did not think we had any choice but to stand up to them. But they didn't have the money or the equipment. The British are so tough. I mean, I think I'm something of an Anglophobe, but their vices and their virtues are the same. That steadfastness, that stubbornness in the face of reality, standing there, it served them well in the war, and it served all of us well in the airlift. There's a quote right there at the beginning where the British, who used professionals, because the RAF had not demobilized in the way the U.S. Air Force had. And there's a quote there from a young lieutenant who later became an air marshal saying, the Americans were really amazing. You'd be talking to a fellow after he landed, and you'd find out 2 weeks ago he'd been practicing law in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And it was like that, or teaching at a university, or working a farm.
And I had not realized that the United States Air Force was that young.
It was brand new.
It was brand new.
This was their first big adventure. Before that, they had been part of the Army. And of course, the Army didn't want to do them any favors either. I mean, the jealousy between the services hasn't changed over, not since 1776.
Richard, let me say that in reading it, if they hadn't already, I understand, been a filmmate, you have written this in such a filmic style that I know the people, whether it was Gail Halverson or the Turner, and what his problems were. Your role at USC, you are?
I teach writing and history.
History. Wait, any particular history are you?
Basically, media history, media and society and things like that.
And American history.
If not all American, no. Well, I don't want to confess too much, but even a school like USC, which has gotten very good, our students don't come in knowing any history. So we've got to teach them all history.
Because even as I started to introduce the show, people don't remember 1948.
Well, everybody, I mean, even my colleagues, would generally say, when they say, what do you do? I'm working on a book on the Berlin Airlift. Oh, yeah, when they... That was Kennedy, right, in the 1960s. But it wasn't Kennedy. It was, I mean...
Harry Truman.
It was Harry Truman, and he was dealing with an almost impossible situation with, at the beginning.
Yeah.
No tools except the daring young men who he had to go out and find.
Yeah. Now we come to the period where there's a call from a man named Malik, who was with the United Nations, the Russian embassy there, a mission. And he calls somebody in Washington and says, if you're ever in town, come meet me.
Right. Well, before that, as you say, the film, the backstory was that Stalin, after the winter passed, General Winter had always won Russia's war, defeated Napoleon, defeated Hitler, and not for a minute did Stalin think that they'd be able to fly these planes through what turned out to be the foggiest winter in European history, which is saying a lot. And in Stalin didn't give news conferences, obviously, but on occasion he would answer written questions. And a Hearst correspondent named Kingsbury Smith had put in a series of questions about the Berlin blockade and about the occupation of Berlin. And Stalin answered them, which obviously meant a signal. And Dean Acheson, who was then in the mid-level of the State Department, noticed that in his statement, Stalin had never mentioned currency reform. And so he thought that was the important part. Everybody else was covering the story of Stalin saying he'd meet with Truman if Truman wanted it. And so Acheson then had Philip Schuyler, fellow at the RUN, Seti Yaakov Malik, was Stalin not mentioning currency reform intentional or a mistake? Yeah. And a couple of weeks later, Malik came back in the men's room and said it was intentional.
What is interesting, too, is at that same time, people like Turner, Clay, did not think that it would be kept up because Harry Truman was running against Tom Dewey.
Right.
Well, I mean, there's a whole famous picture of Truman holding up the newspaper saying, Dewey won, and it was Harry Truman.